So put your hands together for Josh and Sam from Rokrbox.
Howdy, folks. My name is Josh Cunningham. I'm the founder and CEO of Rokrbox.
And I'm Sam Monreal, and I'm a partner and the vice president of business development at Rokrbox. And now that you've seen these two goofy pictures of us, hopefully we feel more relatable.
So Sam and I have spent the last 2 years conducting a ton and ton of research from all the tools we can get our hands on, the National Association of Realtors, ourselves, BoomTown, anything out in the industry to really learn what it takes in the online lead conversion space, how to generate a positive ROI, and how to really lead cultivate like a rock star. So that's the name of our presentation today. But be sure to stay till the end of the presentation because we have a free tool to give to you. Sam and I have actually written a book this last year. It's in the final editing stages and it will be published this year and we want to send you a free copy. So be sure to stay till the end of the presentation to learn how to get your free copy of our book.
All right, so we want to give you a little bit of insight into what it is that you're actually going to learn today. So the number one thing that we really want to make sure that you walk away with is how you can leverage the years of our experience to uncover the shortcut to lead cultivation success.
Yeah, so again, we've been in this space for a very, very long time. We want to give you a couple nuggets that you can kind of use the shortcut instead of taking the long way like we did. We also want to give you some info that can allow you to save an enormous amount of time, energy, effort, and wasted money.
And then finally, a few small adjustments that will equal big results for your team. You know, we've spent the last 4 years figuring out the chocolate chip cookie recipe, so we want to make sure that you know how to make the best chocolate chip cookies in the industry with your leads.
So first things first, before you want to listen to what we have to say, I'm sure you want to know who we are. So I'll start with my story first. How many of you out in the audience like to do Las Vegas? Okay, how many of you ever heard of Las Vegas? All right, that's what I thought. So something happened to me in a Las Vegas nightclub 7 years ago that changed my life forever. It might not be as exciting as you thought, but I met this guy right here on my left shoulder, Frank Klesitz from Viral Marketing. How many viral clients in the house do we have? Any viral clients? So I met Frank when he had 2 employees and 40 clients. They now have about 450 clients and about 40 employees. And I saw what he was doing with viral marketing. I thought it was a really cool, neat, exciting opportunity. And so I literally reached out to him on Facebook and I said, Frank, how can I work for viral marketing but not move to Omaha, Nebraska? Sorry, Jeff Cohn, if you're in the audience. And so that's exactly what I did. I joined viral marketing and over the next 3 years, I had one of the most unique educations in the real estate space that anybody could ever afford. We bought our way into every single real estate coach's event. We bought our way to all the major franchise events. We bought our way into the most prestigious masterminds so that we could connect with all the top industry leaders and learn what the biggest frustrations they were facing so we could better serve them through viral marketing. Well, like Rivers said, I was actually at the 2011 Boomtown Mastermind. There's a nice picture of myself and Rivers and Greer with maybe like a 1-megapixel camera or something. And so we were at that mastermind and everybody went around the room and talked about their biggest frustration with generating online leads. And what could you imagine was probably the most irritating thing that team leaders had to complain about? Their agents not following up with their leads, right? Well, in this mastermind, the concept of the ISA model started to become a little more popular. Rather than give all the leads to the agents and expect them to take it all the way from registration to close, what you want to do is identify one person who can manage all the incoming leads and then dole them out whenever they're ready to meet with an agent. And so I was actually challenged in 2013 while working with one of my viral clients, Spring Benson, out of Ogden, Utah. She had a Boomtown account, her agents weren't following up with the leads, and she was a couple days away from canceling Boomtown altogether. And every time I would talk to her, I would always share all this hypothetical information that I learned, and I would say, Spring, you need an ISA, you need an ISA, you need an ISA. And so finally one day she challenged me and she said, Josh, I know what I have to do, but I just don't have the time, the energy, the effort to do it. Can you help me? And I thought, that sounds like a cool consulting project. Sure. So I bought a one-way plane ticket. I flew to Utah. I lived in her unfinished basement for 2 months, and we applied all the hypothetical models that we had learned in all these masterminds and events to gather what an ISA needs to do. But shortly after I left, it all came crumbling down. See, the problem was we had identified a system for converting leads to opportunities, but the talent that we had hired for it, she was working in a real estate office, seeing all these big commission checks that these realtors are making. So what do you think she went and signed up for? Real estate classes, right? So we were back at square one after investing 2 months into this person. We were back at square one. We had no talent to fill the role. I'm from College Station, Texas, also known as Aggieland, home to Texas A&M. And despite all the Aggie jokes, it actually is a very prestigious university. And so I thought, I can go back to College Station. I can hire a bunch of young, enthusiastic, and sharp Aggies to do this work because it's really not that hard. It's just a matter of doing it. And so that's exactly what I did. In 2013, I left viral marketing. I officially started Rokrbox and started working with a handful of beta clients to figure out what it is that we could do that was scalable to generate opportunities from these registrations. And along the way, as much as I've enjoyed listening to myself talk about myself, I actually ran into this guy right here, Sam Monreal. So Sam, why don't you take it from here and talk about what we did when we met up in 2014.
So in 2014, previous to that, I had worked in the startup world in Austin, Texas, running and managing sales teams for now two huge startup companies. And around that time, actually in 2013, I got into business with Tim Heil, who many of you guys might know. He's actually the keynote on this very stage in 2 hours. So Tim Heil and I got into business together. We had, you know, at that time, Tim had, I think, like 3 employees. And I took over the running of the lead generation team. And so what I saw is that I was able to apply a lot of the tactics that big companies use to run their sales teams in the technology or financial services or any other space by dividing up really what are prospecting and lead generation activities and sales activities. So think ISAs, OSAs, and then agent activities. And we really, really pushed that model hard. As a matter of fact, when I left the Heil Group, we had 10 full-time ISAs on staff, 7 people doing outbound prospecting, and 3 people doing inbound lead conversion. So Josh and I were regularly masterminding because he was building Rokrbox at that time, and then an opportunity came to join Rokrbox, and I leapt at the chance. So now, here we are in 2017, we have also brought on a bunch of really amazing people, like many of you might know, Donna Parrish has come on to lead our ramp-up program. And in that time, we've handled over 400,000 Boomtown registrations. We've got over 50 trained ISAs in addition to a bunch of full-time staff. And we've identified over 50,000 pre-qualified opportunities of real home buyers and sellers that we've talked to on behalf of our clients. So I give you those numbers, guys, to give you some insight into the fact that this isn't something that we're trying out. You know, this is something that we live, breathe, eat, sleep, think about, dream about all day, every day, is how to make this upfront piece of converting internet leads into real qualified home buyers and sellers.
Yes, so we want to combine some of our experiences at Rokrbox as well as the research that we've done to hopefully give you guys some nuggets today that you can take back to your teams and make some significant impacts positively. But first, you might be asking yourself, what in the heck is a Rokrbox? Well, this is a Rokrbox right here. It's an old gold mining tool used in the 19th century for separating sand and gravel from gold. So essentially, that's exactly what we are, just in the real estate space. So Rokrbox today is a professional real estate service used to identify serious buyers and sellers and connect them with highly reliable and successful realtors. And so now we're gonna go ahead and jump into the data here. We got some truth bombs to drop on you today, so I hope you got your pen and pencil ready. But the first thing we need to look at, we wanna take a look at the home market, right? The behavior in the industry as we know it. So I'm gonna ask you, Sam, have we noticed much change in the last decade of what's going on in total home sales?
So this is the interesting thing, guys, is as you guys are real estate professionals, you know a lot has changed in the industry. But the fact of the matter is human beings change pretty slow. And our buying patterns when it comes to actually purchasing homes have remained relatively flat over the past decade, including the really rough years we had in 06, 07, and 08, and the really good years we had last year. So we, as a society, as a country, hover at about 4 or 5 million home sales per year. On the converse of that, let's talk about what's happened in the online lead generation space. So any guesses on whether or not the online lead generation space has kept pace with home sales? Well, it doesn't probably take a rocket scientist to figure out that in 2007, as an industry, we were generating roughly a little under 3 million online real estate leads. Now, in 2016, we're generating well over 120 million online real estate leads every single year. So again, it doesn't take a rocket scientist to see that when you're generating 120 million online real estate leads to serve only 5 million buyers, there's a big disconnect there.
Yeah, and we all know the reasons why. You know, we had pioneers like Boomtown paving the way and demonstrating that it's possible to sell real estate leads and not just real estate. And many, many people jumped on the bandwagon, and now you have a ton of competitors, a ton of aggregators. And the thing is, for one person that buys one actual home, They might be online registering on 10 to 15 different websites. And we also know other websites that actually auction off the leads, right? So if I register once, it might actually go to 3 different realtors, right? So it's an insanely, insanely competitive market that you're all entering in. And so you might want to ask yourself, am I generating a positive ROI on this? Well, let's look at the national averages. It does not look good.
No, this is actually pretty damning information that you guys are about to see here. In 2007, guys, from a $2.6 billion online ad spend as an industry, we generated $3.6 billion in revenue. So that's a 38.5% positive ROI. Well, if you look at what happened in 2015, it's pretty dramatic. For an $8.9 billion ad spend, we only generated $6.1 billion in revenue. So that's a negative 32% ROI. So as a whole, as an industry, we are losing money on our online ad spend. Now, this may seem a little bit surprising coming from guys who specialize in converting internet leads. And so what we want to share with you guys here today is how to have an unfair advantage, how to compete and actually go against the trends of the rest of the industry and actually be successful in this online lead conversion game.
So the point we're trying to make is the industry is changing. It's getting insanely competitive, and you cannot treat your leads the same way you did 10 years ago the way you do now. So let's take a look at what it actually does take to get a positive ROI from an internet lead. And what I want to focus on real quick is what we call a customer life cycle, how to turn a complete stranger into a happy and satisfied customer. So let's just look at the front end of that funnel real quick and how someone actually becomes a stranger and a client. The first thing someone has to do is that you have to attract traffic, right? You have to make it known what problem it is that you solve. Well, how do we do that with internet leads? We do that with Craigslist, we do that with Zillow, we do that with ad spend, with Facebook ads. It's basically that bait that gets someone to come and then land on your site, right? Which is the next step. You have to capture these leads. So you brought the traffic to the site, now you have to give them some compelling information that inspires them to give you your name, phone number, and email address. That's the capturing of the lead. Right, that's Boomtown's job. Then you move on to actually taking all these registrations, which of course some of them are gonna be Scooby-Doos and Mickey Mouses and 555 numbers, but you then have to take all your registrations and then take them through a nurture process to get them to know, like, and trust you and wanna do business with you in one of the biggest financial transactions in their life. That's what we do at Rokrbox. And then the last thing we talk about is the agent activities of what it takes to actually convert someone to a client. And the interesting thing about real estate is realtors actually don't sell homes. What you sell is professional real estate services. So the conversion of the sale actually doesn't happen at the closing table. The conversion of the sale happens when they sign on the line which is dotted, right? The buyer rep agreement. Now you've converted them to a client. And there's a whole nother half of the sales funnel, but we're not gonna get into that today. We're just focusing on the first half of the sales funnel. So let's take a look at the numbers of what's actually trending in the industry of what it takes for you to get one closing. So we're talking about attracting traffic, right? People going to Google and typing in homes for sale in BoomTown USA. Well, for every 1,000 people that click on your ad and go to your website, as soon as Boomtown asks them to give up their information, their name, phone number, email address, the average visit to lead opt-in ratio is about 10%. So that means 900 people just leave your site because you asked for their information. So there's 900 already gone out of the picture. So now you're getting 100 people that you actually capture their information. And again, these are national averages. And so of those 100 people that registered on your website, obviously not everybody's gonna give you their legitimate information. And it's gonna take a lot of work to actually work through all these 100 people and try to get in contact with them and figure out, are they actually motivated and ready to move along and deserve the expertise of a realtor? At Rokrbox, we find about 10% of those are people we can get a hold of and get in touch with, and they agree to speak to a real estate agent. And of the 10 people that we hand over then to the real estate agent, what we realistically expect is 1 to 3 to end up being a closing for you. So you guys can see the amount of work and the investment of time, energy, and effort it takes to get you one closing. 1,000 visitors equals 100 registrations equals 10 opportunities equals 1 to 3 closings. So I encourage you to do the math. What does 1 to 3 closings generate for you in revenue? And is that a positive ROI based upon all the money you're spending in attracting, capturing, and nurturing your leads? That's how you need to calculate your ROI. So it might sound like a doomsday message up here, right? This internet lead game is so competitive, why does anybody want to do it? Well, now let's take a look at consumer behavior, right? What do we like as a consumer these days differently than the way we were 10 years ago? Well, last year's stats from the National Association of Realtors is that 92% of all home buyers use the internet to search for homes. 92%. Every age group, doesn't matter. Old, young, native immigrants, or digital immigrants and digital natives, they're all using technology to search for homes. So you can't just bury your head in the sand and ignore it.
Yeah, I mean, that's one of the things that is really important about what we're sharing with you guys up here is, yes, it's becoming more difficult. Yes, it's becoming more competitive. But, you know, as entrepreneurs and as consummate real estate professionals, we have to make the decision to adapt to the market. If many of you were in business when the market crashed in 06, 07, 08, you know, you could either choose to adapt at that time or you could choose to fall apart, like many real estate professionals did. Well, so, you know, in addition to what Josh was saying about the internet still being the primary resource for most home buyers and sellers, the fact of the matter is most home buyers actually find the home that they actually purchase. This is a survey done of real home buyers. They actually purchase a home that they found first on the internet. Real estate agents are even coming in second on actually helping people find the home that they actually purchase. So we have no option but to thrive in this new internet real estate economy. So what do we have to do in order to actually meet these consumers where they're at, meet these home buyers and sellers in a way that's actually going to be impactful, and then we can thread that needle where our sales funnel as real estate professionals is meeting the home buyers' buying funnel as home purchasers?
So again, the market is insanely competitive, but it's where everybody is, and people are identifying technology as being their primary source of information over you, which is not good, right? The other point we want to make today about today's consumer behavior versus 10 years ago, right? And today we live in an instant gratification society. I think you all would agree with me. Allow me to explain. By a show of hands, how many of you in this room watch television on your time? So when you watch TV, it's HBO Go, DVR, Amazon Prime, right? You're fast-forwarding through every single commercial. Okay, everybody in the room, that's what I thought, right? And how many of you, whenever you have an argument or a dispute or a question, where do you go for answers? You go to the search bar, right? Wherever it may be. Maybe you accidentally got caught in one of those commercials. Where do you go next? You pull out your phone, right? And you start seeking out more information, right? We are in an information overload, instant gratification society. You have to make the commitment today that if you want to win in the online lead generation game, you must become an instant gratification provider.
In addition to that, you know, as Diana Kokoska likes to say, buying a home isn't just a physical move, it's an emotional move. So we have to identify as real estate professionals when that emotional move starts, because there's moving your stuff, but there's the emotional component where you're actually trying to solve a problem. The consumer, the home buyer, is trying to address an issue in their life. They're moving towards pleasure or away from pain. And the best way to identify when that emotional move starts is when that consumer makes the decision to give over their information in that little registration form to continue searching for homes. That is the first indicator that they're actually engaged, something that we can look to see that they're actually engaged in the home buying process.
Yeah, so some of the most fascinating information that we uncovered in our research was, again, a survey by the National Association of Realtors surveying home buyers, not home browsers, right? We all have thousands of home browsers in our Boomtown site, but home buyers, those are the ones that pay your bills and earn commissions, when asked what was the primary reason for the timing of their home purchase, and they were given a multiple choice answer of things like availability of homes or affordability of homes or financing options. What do you think the number one answer was? The number one answer by 46%, it was just the right time. No logical explanation, it was just the right time.
Totally an emotional decision-making process.
So the point here is, guys, although it is one of the biggest financial transactions that people engage in, it is still very much an emotionally driven decision. So it's a competitive industry, it's an instant gratification society, and it's an emotional decision. So Sam, when do you think the best time to contact a lead would be?
So the best time to contact a lead, guys, is exactly when they're in their peak emotional state. So let's pull up another chart here. And this is a chart of data from insidesales.com. And we can actually back up this data from our own research and handling, you know, over 400,000 internet leads. So if you wait even 5 minutes from 5 minutes versus 10 minutes to call an internet lead, your chances of making contact or qualifying that lead drop by 400%. So guys, I know that this is not news, that you've heard, you know, time and time and time and time and time again that you have to call your internet leads within 5 minutes. Well, it's not even now a nice to do or a you should do or gosh, it sure would be nice if you could get around to. This is absolutely an imperative. It is a no choice thing anymore. You have to call the leads within 5 minutes or less, because if you miss that window, they're gone. They've moved on to something else. They've moved on to some other real estate company's website or something like that. That is the best opportunity. So if you are not right now calling every single Boomtown registration within 5 minutes or less, you are missing out on the number one strategy, the most productive activity that you can perform in which to convert internet leads at the highest level.
Yeah, a lot of consumers are unaware of the information that they're actually receiving, so they'll jump on your site and they don't find any homes that fit their criteria, and then they go seek out another site and another site and another site thinking there's different data, but we all use the same data. So that's why if you're not capturing them within 5 minutes, they're already on to your competitor's site. So again, the golden secret here, we're opening up the vault and giving it all away, call every lead within 5 minutes. Pretty simple, right?
Easier said than done.
Yeah. Now, again, another fascinating statistic that we found through the National Association of Realtors survey of buyers last year was the average number of homes, or an average number of weeks that a home buyer searched for homes, and it wound up being 10. But even more interesting than that, the average number of weeks searched before contacting an agent was only 2. And again, I know this is different because we all look at all of our leads in Boomtown and we see all the activity that happens in there, but again, we want to study the data of people that actually make decisions and buy homes, not the data of people that are wasting all your time and utilizing all your free resources. So 2 weeks, someone wants to buy a home, they're registering, they're searching for 10, and in the first 2 weeks, they reached out to an agent.
So guys, this is really important distinction that you need to make here is we need to stop thinking about the leads that are generated within your site as this sort of evergreen thing. This thing that has unending value. The fact of the matter is, internet leads are basically have about the same shelf life as produce at your local grocery store. If you're not capturing that lead's attention, particularly with the real home buyers and sellers, within that first 2 weeks, again, you've missed the window. So we've got to get out of this mindset that we have months and months and months and months and years and years and years in which to nurture these folks. Because the fact of the matter is, the real home buyers and sellers, not browsers, but the real home buyers and sellers are making that decision very rapidly in which to engage with a real estate professional.
So what do you do if you don't get in touch with them the first time?
Call them a bunch more times, right? Your chances of getting in touch with a lead increase to about 90% if their contact information is valid by the 6th call attempt. But what is the reality? Most salespeople and real estate agents, in addition, quit after the first call attempt, maybe make 2 call attempts, dramatically diminishing their contact rates by nearly 70%. So guys, again, big secrets here. Call leads within 5 minutes and then call them a bunch more times. At Rokrbox, we call all of our leads 10 times, send them 4 text messages and 4 emails after the first attempt.
So again, it's very, very, very important to be very persistent in your efforts. And we know we have a lot of tools, but let's talk about the actual media types that are converting at a really, really high level. Again, I know we told you we had some good nuggets for you. Unfortunately, the punchline is it still requires a lot of work, guys. And so the most effective types of media that convert opportunities is 1, phone call, 2, text message, and 1, email. And now I'm about to give you a little bit more data that might be a little bit more discouraging about the amount of work that you're gonna have to do. It's actually 74% phone call, 25% text message. If you do the math there, that only leaves what? 1% for email, guys, right? Your email drips don't do the work for you. They can do a great job of establishing you as a local expert and educating people on the home buying process so that when you pick up the phone and you say, I'm with XYZ Real Estate, it might actually recall the information that you've been sending them, but the emails are not gonna convert the leads. You have to pick up the phone. You have to use the text templates in Boomtown. You have to text with your mobile app. This is how you convert leads. It actually requires work, unfortunately, still.
Uh, Oh, okay, great. So going back to the consumer life cycle here, we want to talk about, you know, again, BoomTown can do a perfect job. BoomTown and AdWords and Facebook and everything like that can do a perfect job of attracting and capturing the traffic. Rockrbox or whatever resource you use internally, your own internal ISAs, your agents, can do a perfect job of nurturing these leads, but it still relies on the agents to handle that final crucial step in the lead conversion process in the consumer lifecycle. So in a recent survey that we did of top BoomTown teams, we realized there's still a big gap in the activities that the agents are performing in order to convert the leads at the highest level. So there's still pervasive in the industry agents scheduling appointments to meet with the client for the first time at the home. The statistics are overwhelming that if you meet with a prospect in the office, have a formal buyer presentation that you perform, and you actually present them with a buyer representation agreement, which they sign, you have a greater likelihood of converting that lead into an actual paying customer. So remember earlier in the presentation, Josh said that in this section of the consumer lifecycle, the buyer representation agreement is actually when they convert to a client. And so that step right there, the in-office appointment, the formal buyer presentation, the actual signing of the buyer rep, that is the most crucial step that the agents can perform in the consumer lifecycle to convert to a client.
So we feel like we've given you some good nuggets today. Again, it's not rocket science. It's just consistent execution over time. And again, it's much easier said than done. So now we want to take a little bit of time in our presentation to focus a little bit more about culture, right? This is the system. This is what you have to be doing. But who do you actually get to do it, and how do you create an environment that's a conducive, or an environment that's conducive to productivity, right? So we wanted to just kind of give you a couple tips of things that we've done in our office to create a productive work environment and a competitive work environment and an accountable work environment so that we can achieve high results for our clients. And the first thing we want to talk about, and I'd invite you all to kind of review what your own policies and procedures are, but what does your hiring and training process look like, right? We know what we have to do, but who's going to do it? Where are we going to find them? What is your source for talent? And then what is your process for getting them ramped up? Well, at Rokrbox, like I said, we're in College Station, Texas, and we're there on purpose because I have 55,000 bright and sharp students across the street that for the time being in that town, the only part-time jobs they could have is go make sandwiches at Subway or go slang beers at Northgate. And so we give them an opportunity to actually invest in themselves and prepare themselves for the next steps in their career by coming into Rokrbox and learning sales and real estate and recruiting and technology and entrepreneurship, and that's where we actually find our talented source of employees. So do you have a good, consistent pool of talent in your hometown where you know you can go and count on reliable, consistent, sharp, and enthusiastic candidates for your team? And then as far as the training process, before we even onboard an employee, the most important step in our interview process is an observation. So after an online interview and a phone interview, an in-person interview, and personality assessment, at the conclusion of that in-person interview, we know if someone would be good at making phone calls. But we tell them, I know you would be good at this work, but the last step is to invite you back for an observation. We want you to spend one whole hour with our team, with one of our most senior reps. They're going to give you a full tour of what it is that we do, how we start off each shift, the technology we use, the calls we make, the scripts we use. And at the conclusion of that, I need you to write me an email explaining how well you feel you would fit with our culture. This is your interview of us. So do you have something like an observation within your business where you're taking people out with a team or maybe taking them out to dinner or giving them some exposure to what your expectations are before they actually walk in the door and are expected to deliver it, right?
And you'll notice here, guys, we're identifying in a very streamlined way about a 40 to 50 step process before somebody even gets on the phones for the very first time. So if we're going through that with an hourly wage employee, it's worth reviewing what you're doing with a potential real estate agent, which is a highly skilled professional, which in most markets should be earning a six-figure salary. So you can't skip that upfront step because you can't transform a bad hire into a great hire over time. It just doesn't work that way.
And so then let's talk about the training process. Do you just ask us for our slides and hand it to them and say, this is what you're supposed to be doing? Or do you have a very lengthy process that's documented, that's digital, that's online, that's in paper? Do you have quizzes? Every single one of our shifts starts off with a quiz. It has homework. They're writing out scripts while they're off the clock at home, and they have to come in prepared for the next shift, and they have to pass the test before they can even start their training, right? How intense is your training process? Do you just hire a bunch of bodies and throw them at the wall and see what sticks? Or do you have a very intense training process that you're committed to investing in your team to not just tell them what they need to be doing and not just provide them with the tools, but actually, again, create an environment that's conducive for their growth?
Yeah, so one of the other things that we actually learned at BoomTown UNITE, I guess it was 2 years ago, was the power of a daily huddle. Really just this 5 or 6 minute opportunity for the team to get together before a shift starts, and we share some education, we script practice and we role play, we do a little bit of connecting. You know, we actually took some of those like little dinner party cards that have questions like, you know, who would you have dinner with if you could eat with anyone in the whole world? And it gives the team an opportunity to connect with each other. And then most importantly, we set goals for the day. Because daily goals are really important for salespeople in helping them have a really near target that they know that they've had a good day if they hit it by the end of the day. So at the beginning of our shift, every single one of our callers identifies how many opportunities that they are going to identify on behalf of our clients from their internet leads.
Yeah, exactly. So again, a huddle. That's another thing that we recommend. Does each of your days start with a huddle? If you're wanting your team to come together and do similar activities, are you providing an environment where that's possible? And if you're going to be setting goals, do you have true accountability to follow up with that, right? What happens if they don't meet their goals? What happens if they do meet their goals, right? How often are you meeting with them one-on-one to inspect their pipelines and audit the leads that you have invested for them, right? That's true accountability. So what accountability measures do you have in place in your business? Because again, we've worked with hundreds of teams and we've done everything that we've done and we've told them everything that they've needed to do. But the reason why we love BoomTown, why we've worked with them for so long, is they're such a culture-driven organization. We feel like we're a very culture-driven organization, and we're excited to work with real estate teams that are very culture-driven organizations. And this is really the foundation that you need to lay in order to do all these activities, because making phone calls isn't the funnest thing to do on earth, right? Facing rejection over the phone isn't the best thing to do on earth, right? But do you have an environment that is a safe space for people to come to and to conquer their goals together? One other thing that we do at Rokrbox is we host masterminds. We choose the frequency of every 3 weeks just because we find that 2 weeks is too much and 4 weeks is not enough. But every 3 weeks, we take our entire team out for a fajita dinner and we go around the table one by one by one and offer every single person in the company, no matter if they've been there for 4 years or 4 days, to give their insight as to what's our greatest strength as an organization and what's our greatest opportunity. So do we have inefficiencies? Are there unclear expectations? Is there things that we can improve on? And then also, what are we doing great at, right? What are the things that maybe we've already changed, but we're actually getting feedback from our people that are acknowledging that there's an impact of that, right? So this is creating a safe space where people can come together and understand that every single member of the team, every single member of the company, their opinion counts and their insight matters, and we care about them, right?
And in those masterminds, we actually take a moment at the very beginning where anyone on the team can identify someone else within the organization that has been living our core values. Because we want our core values as an organization to be a living, breathing thing, something that we're imbuing into what we do on a day-to-day basis. So it gives an opportunity for the team to recognize each other and, like Josh said, a safe space where a brand new, you know, hourly wage employee can be talking directly to the CEO and giving feedback about the way they think that the organization can improve. It creates a very flat, transparent organization where everybody knows that they're rowing in the same direction and everybody feels like they have value and input into the health and strength of the organization.
I'm also a very, very firm believer that there is no neutral. You're either growing or you're diminishing. So what things do you have within your organization that help people with their career development, right? Hopefully nobody wants to be exactly where they're at right now in 5 or 10 years, right? So do you have a clear path within your organization for people to step up and become leaders, for people to step up and become sales managers, or to move in and oversee more administrative staff, right? Is when someone joins your organization, is it just do this job for right now and we'll be happy forever? Or is there a very clear path that you can show them that if you invest in them and they invest in the company, that there's a reciprocal growth between the two of you and you can achieve your goals together? At Rokrbox, we currently have 100% job placement with all of our students. They either stay with us full time or they go on and have multiple job offers in some sort of sales profession. And we're very, very excited about it. And again, I think it's something that you all should consider as well, as what type of career development path you have within your organization other than here's some leads, work them and close them and I'm gonna take a split of your commission, right? So we've actually been doing a ton of research on this as well. Again, we understand that we can get it so far through the customer life cycle, but then there's a handoff to an agent and there's a cultural foundation that has to be established in order for people to be productive in these activities. So we recently just spent a couple weeks out on the road this winter and went and visited some of our clients so we could actually get in their office, spend a couple days in their office, meet with their agents face-to-face, talk to them about what their huddles look like and what their script and dialogue practice looks like and what their accountability meetings look like and what their career development looks like. And we actually hired a camera crew to follow us around, so we've got a nice little video for you if you want to cue that up, just so you can get a little bit of insight into some of the research we're continuing to do about how you can build a very, very powerful, productive culture within your organization. So let's take a look. We're here today on site visiting some of our Rokrbox clients, and more importantly, engaging in more of a face-to-face interaction with the agents that we work with every day. What we find over and over again is that the agents really don't have a big picture perspective of how exactly the entire real estate transaction happens from turning a complete stranger into a happy and satisfied customer.
The really amazing things about these on-sites is it's kind of an old school way of getting a new school message across about what are the things that agents need to be doing to stay competitive and stay front and center and stay relevant in this new online lead generation and lead conversion landscape.
Not only did they motivate me to be better, but they gave me the tools to know how to be better. With tools, with motivation, and with appreciation for what they do.
I have been a client of Rokrbox's for about 3 years now, having Sam and Josh in office explaining to my team all the work that goes into getting a lead, whether it is an online lead or even just a sign call, and the process that it goes through has really been beneficial for my team to see. For me, it's been great to also have them in the office to strategize, mastermind, think of bigger ideas, as well as hear what their other clients are doing that's working in their markets.
Providing that insight as to who's responsible for what tasks so that the agents can stay involved in the highest income producing activities, which is actually working with motivated buyers and trying to convert them to a client.
I'm a fairly new agent, and my first full year as an agent, I actually had 25 closed transactions, and I would equate a lot of that to what Rokrbox does. And the system that our team has in place is just very efficient and effective.
And that's exactly what the combination of BoomTown and Rokrbox and the agents' activities create, is a great business model that's predictable and duplicatable and provides an opportunity for people to gain their lives back.
I don't worry and wonder if my team is calling them back, because I know, you know, if I'm a 6 o'clock, 7 o'clock movie, that Rokrbox is on it. I know that the next morning, if we get something that comes in after midnight, which happens all the time, I know that the next morning they're gonna get a call first thing.
We're hoping to provide a ton of insight and feedback to these agents so that they know exactly the foundation that's been laid before them, that they know all the tools that have been provided for them that can help set them up for success.
We brought our leadership team out here to meet with our clients so that we could have conversations directly with agents, just like we would with your agents, so that they're getting a really focused, really important message about the techniques, tactics, and strategies that they can deploy to get the best results. If you've had success with BoomTown, if you're having success with Rokrbox, scheduling an on-site to have our team come out to the office is the number one thing that you can do to take it to the next level. Reach out to me, Sam, at rokrbox.com to schedule your on-site today.
All right, thanks again, guys. I hope we've given you a ton of information today. Like I said, we are writing a new book. It'll be out later this year. If you'd like to get a free copy, go to freeconversionsecrets.com right now and go ahead and put your name and mailing address, and we'll be sure to mail you a copy for free as soon as it gets printed before the end of the year.
It won't be this awesome leather-bound version either.
Yeah, and then also included with that is going to be all of the interviews with myself and Sam, the authors of the book. We'll send you all those MP3s as well. So basically, we're just trying to give you a little taste today of everything that's in the book. And again, the book is entirely free. What other tools do we have for them, Sam?
If you want to check out a recent interview that we did with Forbes Riley, who's the queen of selling, she sold over $5 billion worth of products on TV, and Kevin Harrington, who you may remember is the original shark on four seasons of Shark Tank. You can check out that interview that we did with Forbes and Kevin at rockerbox.com/interview.
Yeah, and Kevin actually threw us out a nice quote by saying, Rokrbox is the most innovative team in online lead conversion for real estate professionals. And then lastly, if you want to learn more about Rokrbox or what it is that we do, we'd love to buy you a drink this afternoon. Everybody is invited. There's a happy hour at Republic Garden and Lounge from 4 to 7. We'll be out on the patio, so come see us. We've also got a bunch of our team here in Rokrbox t-shirts. So if you see anybody wearing a Rokrbox t-shirt, come up and grab us and talk our ear off. But again, free drinks and some snacks at Republic Garden Lounge from 4 to 7. Invite anybody else you know that didn't get to make it here today. Again, my name is Josh. This is Sam Montreal. I want to thank you for your time, and hopefully you learned how to lead cultivate like a rock star.
Thanks for your time.
Thank you.